Hello, thank you for joining me today. Today I'm going to paint a New York scene, and it's in fact the first time I've tried to paint a New York scene, so it should be interesting. Here I have a sketch I actually did in another video, which I'll link in the description, explaining a bit how I came up with the idea and how I was planning for this painting. I came up with a sketch with help from two reference photos, this one and this one, because I liked the lights and most of the composition in this one, but I wanted to include the Empire State Building and get rid of those trees, so I kind of did a mixture of the two, and this is what I came up with. So let's get on with it. I'll put that to a side. I've oriented the camera this way, portrait orientation, because I think ultimately it's better for seeing the details. If I had it the other way around, it would be a bit more difficult to see because it would be a bit smaller. And I've noticed that most people watch my videos on their mobile devices or tablets anyway, so YouTube should account for that and orientate it a bit better for you to watch. So the palette is to my side, but I'll explain which colours I'm using as I use them, and I'll show you when I put them on. Let's get on with it. Don't think I'm missing anything else. I'll also show you the brushes that I'm using as I go through them. This is the first time I've actually recorded myself painting, and first time I've had to speak whilst doing a painting, so a little out of my comfort zone, but it should be good practice for me, because I want to be able to talk while I paint. I'd like to be able to teach, and I think it'll help improve my skills too. So I'm just deciding which brush I should use for the sky, and I'll have to pre-mix all my paints before I even start, because there'll be no time for that once I've applied it to the paper and wait for it to dry. If it already dries when I'm still mixing the paint, it'll be too late, so I have to pre-prepare all my paints beforehand for the first wash. So I'm just gonna do the sky for the first wash, and then cover a few highlights, which I'll then go over with darker paint. So, let me think. There will be a few moments of silence when I concentrate, but hopefully that won't be too bad or for too long. So, in fact, I'll just adjust the angle of the painting so the water runs down rather than up. I'll use yellow ochre here with a bit of burnt sienna to give it a golden sunset look, because I'll have a lot of street lights here illuminating. I've already obviously pre-drawn it and added a bit of masking fluid. It would have taken far too much time if I were to record that as well, because I'm not totally sure how long this video will be. Could be 2 hours, could be 4 hours. Hopefully I'll do it in one go. You can always click forward to when I actually start painting. Yellow ochre, burnt sienna, cerulean blue here. I'll be having a lot of purple in the shadows later, so maybe I'll put a hint of purple also in the sky, just to harmonise that. Okay, I'm going to start mixing. I'll start mixing the blue first. Bit of ultramarine. This will be quite pale. I don't want to add too much colour to the sky because I want the contrast to be quite strong with a light sky and a shadowy array of buildings. So that's the blue sorted. Ultramarine and the yellow ochre, sorry. And a bit of burnt sienna up there, but maybe add a bit of cabin red. Oh, that was too much. I'll put this palette down now that I've mixed the colours because it's ultimately easier for me to paint with that down. Moving fast, I'll add a little bit of texture for clouds, like I say, it's not that strong, but it's not really meant to be at this stage. A little touch of purple, like I said, a bit of the spray gun to help it move. Now I'm going to start influencing, adding a little bit of yellow ochre, the yellow ochre mix. And basically I'll just go back and forth with that. Being careful not to mix them too much, go back and forth too much, because it'll start creating green, obviously, yellow and blue. More of that yellow ochre. Coming down there. Add a bit more purple. I vary the amount of water on my brush in order to change, mix the effects that I am getting. Less water means obviously less goes on, so it doesn't spread as much. If I were to load my brush fully, it would spill out and be more, it would make more of an intense reaction. So it's all very subtle, but I think for the sky, that will do. Maybe add a bit more red there at the bottom. Okay, this box here, I'm gonna fill that in with yellow ochre, a mix of yellow ochre, not a pure pigment of it, because I want that to glow later when I paint a negative shape around it. Yellow ochre and go a bit thicker. Yellow ochre and burnt sienna. Let me know in the comments if there's any other subjects you want me to do or how I can improve or make this more useful for you. I plan to do all types of videos relating to my brushes, palettes, technique, like more philosophical concepts on painting. I'm still learning, obviously, though. I'm not claiming to be a master or anything, but I feel like recording myself and exploring this medium online in the community will help me improve. This building here, I'm just going to dab out a bit, use my tissue to dab out that colour. And I'm going to change to a smaller brush, because this particular building, I want to be a different hue, different colour. That's too strong. Yeah, I can't tell how long this painting will be because it depends on how many mistakes there will be, how many back and forths I have to go. Obviously, watercolour is quite an impulsive medium, rather unpredictable. So you have to go with the flow, and sometimes the flow isn't that easy to go with, I guess. And I'm sorry if there's any background noise. It's quite difficult to do a full painting without noise appearing every now and then. I've tried to find the quietest location to do it. And hopefully that'll be enough. Go to a medium-sized brush now, just to add some more colour there, I think. What colour will I go for? I'll go for a cooler colour, I think, because I'll be adding a warm shadow on this side, I think. So I want to put a cool undertone to kind of balance that. Go back with the yellow ochre now and fill this out. I'm just thinking, just planning ahead. I think I'll paint the road this first section as well, rather than waiting for this to dry and then do that. But it's something I've got to mentally prepare for, because there's quite a few intricate details that have all got to be done within a certain amount of time before any of it dries. So it's like you run through it in your head, you rehearse it in your head, and just act, and hopefully it'll turn out okay. If not, the painting would be fluffed, I guess, if that's the right word. So, I'm thinking it's going to start off blue. It's going to be a purple in these sections, and that glow of the sunset is going to make it a bit more warmer here, all whilst keeping the whites of the road markings. I don't need to be so concerned about painting over the cars, because they're all darker than this wash anyway. Okay. So I'll show you the palette again. Instead of taking directly from the black, I'm going to mix my own kind of grey colour with ultramarine, burnt sienna, and alizarin crimson. A bit cooler, bluer. So that's going to be my base colour. Then I'm going to separate them. I'm going to make a warmer one here. Add some purple into that. That purple there, it's not necessary to have it in your palette, because you can mix it quite easily with those two, but I find I use it quite frequently, so it's useful just to have its own palette. I guess most of them, well, not most of them, but a lot of colours or extra colours I have are like that. And you must also make sure you have enough of the mixture, because you don't want to run out of that before you finish the area that you want to paint. Okay. It's weird having such a tense moment so early on, but so I'm just making sure, just planning it, just to make sure I do it right. But I'm gonna put it flat. Okay. Spray it. Ideally, I wouldn't have sprayed it, because it stops the lines being so crisp on the road markings. But it's a compromise. So that's the vanishing point. So I just I'm aiming to just in a way, it's difficult to tell how this will affect the whole painting, because there's not a much, well, there's no details yet to kind of compare it to. This road marking won't be the main center of interest, so it doesn't need to be totally correct whatsoever. In fact, it shouldn't have as much detail because you don't want it to take the attention. It should just be enough detail for it not to stick out. Okay, so add a little more depth here and here. Maybe a single line up there, up there. Get some more blue in a certain area there. Of course, I'm recording this not knowing whether this painting will be a success and whether I'll ultimately upload it. It's quite possible it won't work out and I'll just be talking to myself for no reason. While it's still wet, I need to add some warmth down here, but I can't, while it's drying, I must be careful not to add too much water or it will cauliflower, so to speak. Okay, I will add that tint back again because you see it's starting to form a cauliflower there. Which is sometimes not really a problem because it adds a bit of texture and you can get away with it, but I don't want that particular bit to have that texture, basically. So as it dries, different levels of wetness around, you have to calculate where you want to put more pigment and how much pigment and what consistency of pigment in order to get the effects that you want. And in the future I'll do a video of all the different combinations of wetness, pigment thickness. Okay, I think for the first layer that is done. So I will pause the video to save the noise of the hairdryer and come back. So now that I've done the lightest parts, I'm going to do the medium colours, the mid-tones. And while I was planning, I was thinking about my next step whilst I was drying. So there's a part there that I'll do basically the tops of the buildings that aren't in shadow. Okay. I'll start from left to right so that my hand doesn't obviously go in the wet parts. Use this brush. Use this brush because I can paint the sections that I want and then use a bit of dry brushing instead of having a hard edge. I can add a bit more there, in fact. And as you can see, or may have even noticed from the beginning of the video, my palette was quite dirty. But I used those bits in the corners, those dry bits, to kind of neutralise the colours, because I don't want pure pigment. I wanted them a bit dirty. I've basically got three kinds of brushes from my three favourite artists, Alvaro, Chung and Joseph Zbukvic. this mixture was yellow ochre and cadmium red again. Go up and dab various bits just to add a bit of intrigue. I'm always tempted to add more colour than I think I should do. Like at this stage I feel, oh, there's no problem adding colour, but then later on, because this part here is more colourful, there's nothing to contrast it with later on. So the main focus down here challenges it for attention. Competes with it rather than challenges it. So when I look at my reference image, I'm basically separating it into different layers. That's how I try and work out how to paint it. So I look at the highlights and see where they need protecting. Then I look at the midtones and see how I could mix and merge them in interesting ways. And do them all in one go. And then, of course, the darkest darks can be done after that, once it's dry. And there's a point when these mid-tones turn, go too dark for them to be mid-tones, and I save them to do later. When I can, I try to do my painting in two washes, the background wash, and then finish the painting in the next wash, and then add details. But with this particular painting, I can see there's too many different elements to simplify it that much. I'm already simplifying it quite a lot. So I'm doing yellowy, warm buildings here because the shadows will be bluey and purpley. And I'm only painting the bits now that can't mix with the shadows, have to be hard and separated. When I come to the next stage, when I'm doing the majority of the shadows, I'll merge them together. I'll control the merging, but I have to paint these on the bottom first, underneath. I think, okay, I'll just, I don't usually like to have so many hard edges away from the focal point. But hopefully, as I add more details close to the end, it won't be so bad. won't be so obvious. Okay, I'll use the hairdryer again. I think I'm going to add another green mark similar to that on the other side. Now I'll be coming over this later with a very thick brush, a very heavy loaded brush, so I don't need to be so concerned about how neat it is, it's just the colour. A bit of dry brush up the top of there, and now we're ready to go onto our darkest darks. I'm going to be using this brush again. I'm going to use black as the base just to make things quicker. Add a bit of green. I'm just feeling, trying to feel what's right rather than consciously working out scientifically. Or I'm just mixing colours and looking at it and thinking, okay, I think that's what I'm going for. And I need to think about how far it goes down before I stop. Before I can stop. So I've put that first blot down, and I'm going to use that blot to, I'll put a second one down actually first, but I'm going to use that blot to get pigment from there rather than from my palette, and then when I feel like it's the right value or right shade, so to speak, then I can leave it alone and get more pigment from my actual palette. I'm just thinking of, okay, eventually I'm going to have a straight line there. I don't think I'm going to do it right now. I think what I'm going to do is fill it in, actually, and then I'll show you a technique I use to bring back the greens. A negative shape there, so I don't want it to be so clean, so I'm just adding a bit of texture. I'll wait for it to dry a bit and then I'll flick it with a bit of brush water. As it comes across here, I'm going to add a few different colours just to give it an interest, so it can blend or merge, so to speak, into this building. Brush. Add a few brush strokes there. Okay, I'm gonna have to, before this dries, I'm gonna have to bring this across and simultaneously bring it down before any of it dries. And that means going to a bigger brush, because I have to be fast about it. it's almost like checkpoints. Like, there's, you've got to keep on painting non-stop until you reach a point where you can afford to have a break, because you can't allow for gaps, for moments to dry. I guess through experience and trial and error, you can work out where those points are. Cerulean blue. So I'm covering this area with kind of a medium thickness of blue, just to cover it. And then I'm gonna go back up here with a very loaded brush and allow it to run. Then as it dries, I can go up and add further lines. I should have gone even darker there, but I can fix that later. Go back here to this line because I'm not so happy with it. I'm just going to add it a bit more texture. Few splats there on the edge. Underneath here needs to be brighter, so I'm going to try and fix that now. I have to come back to that later. Likewise, there's a red dot here. I want to have coming through. like using a dark ultramarine. Gonna come across there like that. And down there like that, a bit thicker. Gonna get my rigger brush. Dirty yourself a bit. In fact, I'll dirty that line up even more. Because I don't want there to be a sharp line there, otherwise it'll be too much of a distraction. Go back to this brush and work my way up. I'm not going to go down here until later. I'm going to come across here, go down there. I think that's too green looking. Well, it's not green, but a greeny looking brown. So I'm going to add red in there. Few more lines in here now. It's not completely dry, but time to do some windows as well. Add some lavender in here. No, that's too much. Trying to think of a technique to imply all the windows on the building without actually individually painting them, because that wouldn't look good individually painting them. it can be quite easy for most of the process to be thinking it's not looking the way you want. But very often that's the case in watercolour, because you have to do things in an indirect way, I guess. So there's lots of areas that I'm not happy with, but I understand at the same time that they need to be done that way in order to complete the painting the way I want it, and ultimately in the end. So I think I'm just gonna do these lines to imply windows, and then some of them I'm going to emphasize a bit more detail, and some of them adding some running water there to abstract some details. I think I'm going to come back to the details on the Empire State Building, because it's difficult to judge when I haven't done the details in the more important places. Okay, there's a deep purple, ultramarine. Opportunity. Right here. That's a very thick brush mark. And that's going to mirror that over here too. Do quite a big mixture. Of burnt sienna. Bigger brush. This one's going to be quite watery. Because I want the magic of watercolour to do it by itself, really. So all I've got to do is introduce them and they should do it themselves. Ideally. So I'm not painting every window, implying some, and then hopefully the eye does that for you. It needs some interfering, just a bit. I'm going to go over it again. So I'm just thinking. I'm finding it hard to tell now where my, well, I'm just finding it difficult to tell which areas are completely dry and which areas are still wet, so. I think I'm gonna have to use the hairdryer again. Okay, I had some reflection whilst I was drying it, and there's a few areas that I need to sort out. I should have gone darker here, so I'm going to have to go over that again, unfortunately. To force myself to go darker this time, I'm going to put pure black in the areas that I need to. There's a building here that I've painted over, so I'm going to try and restore it. To do that, I've used plain water, fill it in. And then wait a few seconds to wet the for the pigment to wet, and then I rub it away like that. And I'm going to start off with a brown colour. Burnt sienna. Keeping it very thick. Well, it's actually, it's not thick, it's just heavily loaded. The consistency isn't that thick of pigment. And now, I'm gonna do an even bigger wash of purple on top of that. Purple or ultramarine. And then it's gonna run and hopefully do some appealing effects. Every now and again leaving a little mark that is in line with the perspective. Change my brush. I like these two buildings dark because it kind of closes the canvas. It locks in the viewer, I think. I get the feeling that's what it does. There's no compositional theory. Well, it seems to make sense that way. I'm going to be very bold and put very thick black paint there. Trying to get a brush, dry brush strokes there. I find dry brush strokes are one of the hardest things to control so far for me. Few splashes. Some controlled chaos. Put a little bit of green here. So hopefully this green, now that I've just touched it slightly, will pour out there and do something interesting. But if it doesn't, oh well. I don't want to mess around with it too much, so if it doesn't do anything spectacular, then so be it. A few dabs of red. Going with the black again for the top. And there's a single, I've got to be very careful here. I'll do. Don't know if that was necessary, but I did it anyway. Now while that's running, I'm going to take this pyrrol orange. Big dot there. Hopefully it'll run and do something cool. I think I'll do that on the other side too. Now I'm going to come to the other side. Well, actually before that, well, I'm going to fill that in. I like the clean edge there, but I have to integrate it somehow. I guess that'll do. Black strokes there. Quite abstract this side. Really, this should have been like that the other side too. I guess I wasn't brave enough at the beginning. There you go, some purple here. So here, I'm going to change to the small brush because I'm going to try and add a tree there, or the outline to a tree in the distance. It's quite a difficult thing to get right, and it's one attempt. It's dry brush, it's thick pigment. So I'll use this thing to mix a very thick pigment, dark pigment. I've got dark on this side, light on the other side. Okay, that should be okay. That should be all then needs. I don't want to overdo it. Then I'm going to bring in some blue with the purple and go over the top of this car. And a little highlight there. I've got lots of colours there, but you do need greys in order to bring out those colours. So I'm just going to add a grey there. A lot of water there. There we go. Some dry brush. Impulsive, unexpected dry brush. I'm going to run some more water down there. Down here. Okay, now I'll try and leave it alone. I think I left too many marks up here. So I'm mixing a get rid of some. I'm going to attempt this window again. Actually, no, I'm not. I'm going to wait until the end to do that because I want to focus on the more important things. I'm going to do something here. I'm going to wet this area here. And I'll wait a bit on that. And then while I'm waiting for that bit to wet and dry out a bit even, I'm going to do a little something here. I find it depends on how much detail you need, but I find it's easier to go abstract first and then draw in the details than to do the details first and then do the abstract after that. That's why I feel like this section was a struggle and this section I'm more positive on it, even though it's not finished yet and it looks quite messy. I feel like there's more potential there. I'm gonna take some of this, steal some of this perennial. Cover it here. Looks messy, but I'll be so strong with the other pigments that it'll be barely noticeable. Going into some heavy pigment now. I'm going to create a big batch of it because I always go too weak and end up having to go over it anyway, redo it. And it looks much worse the second time around. So I'm going to try and be a bit brave and go into it. So I'm going to add a few random dots of red. And the same with blue. My hope is that they'll dry together and mix together to create some nice effects. I'm going to create the line in which I don't want to go any further down. Big mishmash of colours. Too much effort, if You know what I mean? It looks too try hard. It doesn't look good. I'll do the same thing over here too, actually. I'll get this brush a bit. Splat a bit, spray a bit. And soften. Quite a weird thing to see softening with a brush like this on a watercolour painting, but I think it does its job. It blurs, it's like a lens, a focus lens, a lens on the camera. Focus, it's not what a focus lens is, but it, by that I mean it makes it so you can get away with less details. Still not finished. I still feel that attracts too much attention. People are going to want to look at that when really it shouldn't be any more significant than there or anywhere random. I don't want it to have any significance in the painting. Where I can push the values darker. I'm going to add a bit of red here because I'm going to do the car purple. Well, it'll be black, but with a purple light source reflecting on it. So having that red there will help distinguish it a bit. But before I do that, I'm going to go over it again with the hairdryer, flatten the paper out. Okay, I'm going to start here and work my way across. But actually, I feel like the road needs to be a bit darker. And I'll do that before I paint the car. I'm going to do that with dry brush too. because I have a bit, with dry brush I'll have a bit more control over where exactly it goes. I don't have to be so concerned about going over those road markings. Okay, that's enough of that. Onto the car. So I will use gouache or gouache to go over the details once it's dried. And I've already got the masking tape on the lights. So I'm just going to go straight in with the purple, starting off very wet. So the only point I really need to care about is the bottom of the car, making sure I don't go over that line. I'm painting in the wheels. Now, starting at the bottom, I'm going to paint in black. Touch on top of there. Excuse that noise out there. Now I'm going to add a shadow to go underneath and link those wheels. Going to add a lot more paint to the bottom because even though it looks dark now, as soon as it dries, it'll look lighter again. And now I'm going to put a tiny bit of red on top of there. Soften that line a bit. I'm going to add some red up here. Let that spill out too. And in fact, a bit of red can spill out here too. Time being, that's it with that car. I will come back and deal with it a bit more later. So I've just dried the car out. I'm gonna now loosen some of the lines, the edges. Can't obviously do that when it's wet because it would all blur and disappear. I have to do it when there's more control. I'm going to take this off now to this masking tape just on this sign. One of the problems with masking tape's masking fluid. So it makes things stand out a bit too much. Well, depending on what style you want, of course. So I will bring it back. I will darken it. I'll probably darken it with this big brush again. But this big brush, but not quite yet. Now, let's think about what we're going to do next. Let's just carry on with the details at the bottom for the time being. on the points where I'm gonna spray it with the watercolour. I'm gonna, on the points where there's masking tape, masking fluid, I'm gonna make it a bit darker, because the whole point of putting the masking fluid there on these parts is because I want them to stand out. I want them to have that big contrast, unlike here where I just used it because it would have been difficult to do that negative shape. These are meant to be flags, some of them. So I'll come in and do that. I think it overall needs to be much darker anyway, because it's meant to be the darkest part of the painting. I like these colours, but it makes the buildings look too dark when this is all light down here. So I'm going to go in even darker. But this time I'm going to be a bit more conscious about certain figures, people, pedestrians. Now I'm a bit more comfortable with this area. Just implying the corners of the windows. Not actually drawing the whole window. Make this roof a bit darker. Spray it with a bit of a watercolour, and now I'm going to use, sometimes I use my fingernail, sometimes I use this palette to just scrape away some whites. actually. It's not thick enough to do that, so I'm going to have to make it slightly thicker. That. Put a bit more wet on there. I'll do that to this area while I'm doing it to the other end too. You have to be careful though, you can't make it so wet that it runs, but there we go. So give it a few more seconds to soak in, and I'll come back to that to take away. That's fine. Clean up those bits. Not too happy with those. Okay, now I can go back up here. I need to angle myself so that I can do a straight line in one go. It's not particularly straight to us. Now I can go into this area, do the same thing, picking out little highlights. Implying some windows. But I don't want to overdo it. So that's all I'll do at this stage. Next, I'll move on to this building. Making that bit more green. and then it'll actually get darker as it goes down. That's dry, so I'm going to build that shadow up again. Darker bits to where I want to put highlights later. Going to dry it off again. So there's a lot of this going back and forth between wetting, doing the details and then drying again. It can be quite repetitive. So I'm going to go in this car with more detail. Okay, I'm gonna get out the white gouache. Just very minimal white dots. Just to imply where the car is, where the silhouette of the car is. Gouache is a kind of opaque watercolour, so you can't really use it in the main painting process. But for these small details where you're not doing washes, it comes in quite handy. Detail on that. I'm will come back later to take the masking fluid off, but I'll do it all together. Now, I'm going to carry on with this brush and get some of the figure outlines. Negative shapes. Clean up some of these. I took some of the masking fluid off whilst drying it last time, just because I thought they're too obvious, too big. I can always go in with coloured gouache at the end. More of these buildings. These are windows on this building. Now I'm going to mix some yellow with this orange, some of the taxis in New York. And paint them in there. A bit more of that yellow. Keeping it quite thick. Okay, now I'm going to go in with some darks on those cars that I just did. Bluey dark ultramarine. So I basically do a line underneath where the shadow starts. Two wheels. And a line across to connect the wheels. Random little mini arrows almost coming in to imply the roof of buildings. Do a few dabs on these cars with pure white because I'll come back to them later to make them look like headlights. For this car, get onto specific videos another time about how to paint or draw cars, because really if you can draw them with a pencil it's not that much more difficult to paint them. thinking of ways to finish this side of the painting. I think I'll bring this across. And gradate it out. Keeping it a bit thicker there. I guess that's where my signature will go. But far from there yet. I keep on seeing things that I want to alter or change, and it can go on for a while. Referring to my sketch, because in the photo there are no people there. I might add a person there. Or the indication of a person, rather. Maybe I can zoom in. For these bits. I'm just going to dab this red into those dots, those holes. Make some of them a bit more yellow, a bit of a variety of lights. I'll do a few green ones as well, save some for greens. Do these flags. I don't want to draw too many birds. Actually, that makes it look like there's huge birds doing that close. I want to make them a little bit less, well, more subtle. Really, there's so much going on. There's no need to put those in, but I decided anyway. Light birds in. I'll put some, I'll make these a bit darker to imply they're closer, then they won't look like they're right next to the Empire State Building. I'm going to do two lines across. One there. And let me think. So there's hair there. One across there. Maybe one like that. And now I'm just going to wet and rub. Same again. Wet that line. Rough. I'll do that here. Two. Straight across, connecting it all. Little things, really, but they make quite a big difference. Do the same thing to this telegraph pole, not telegraph pole, traffic light. I'm going to have to rub out this pencil mark best I can. Not really. Okay. It'll have to do. Okay, I think I need to be a bit bolder with the orange. paint the actual over here. Okay, that's fine. Thought I did the red light in the wrong place. I think we're getting close to the end here. Of course, there's only, well, I can feel that it's finished and miss something that I'm not aware of until a few days later. Just the nature of the medium, well, the nature of painting in general. You need to disconnect your eye from it a bit. To see a bit better later on. I think I'm going to sign it in the bottom. There are a few things that I could go on forever. Softening edges, but ultimately I think it's time I disconnect from it, have a little break. It's as much as I can do at that moment. I'll just sign my name here. Orange on top of the blue does tricks to the eyes. keep on seeing things, but it'll never be perfect. So there comes a time when you just have to say, enough's enough, it's there for the time being. Let's peel the paper off at least before I go. So let's compare this with the photos that I was referring to. So the majority of the bottom half is like this, and the building going up there. But of course, editing out the trees and adding the Empire State. So a few minutes after taking the masking tape off and having a good look at it, I thought the sky was a bit too weak, and although originally I wanted it to be weak, I thought maybe adding colour would be better in the end, because there's so many darks here that the contrast is a bit too much. So I quickly put on masking tape to block details, and hopefully it won't be too difficult. It's a bit of a pain, and I should have really thought about it beforehand, and maybe I shouldn't have bothered, shouldn't be bothering to do this step, but it's what my vision is telling me to do, so I'm gonna go ahead. I'm not going to put too much, it's not going to be significantly different, but enough just to make it a bit more vibrant. A bit more noticeable, the sky was almost invisible for. I think a bit more yellow the further down I go. Yellow ochre, that is. And then red, introducing red. All the way down to there. I was thinking maybe do this off camera, but I'm trying to do a complete painting on camera, so I thought, why not? And once it's all dried, I'll do a few zoom-ins, close-ups with the camera to see some of the details. So the paint's dried, and I'm going to call this painting done. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope it's been informative for you. If you've painted along, be sure to upload the photo to Instagram and tag me. My Instagram link is in the description below. Drop this video a like if you've enjoyed it, and consider subscribing, as I'll be uploading more videos soon.